Hey everybody, and welcome back to another Python scripting video. So today we're going to look at 5 scripting tips for beginners. So these are the things I kind of wish I knew as I first started. Some of these you may already know, some of them you might not, but hopefully this will help you guys improve in your scripts. So before we jump into it, I'm going to change this to the scripting workspace over here. And there we go. So the first thing I want to take a look at isn't actually in Blender, it's on the internet. So let's jump over to your preferred internet browser. So if we just do a search for Blender API, we'll find this link here, which is the Blender 2.8 Python API documentation. So go ahead and open this up, and I'll make sure to leave a link in the description. So this is the Blender Python API, or the Blender documentation, and we've got a whole bunch of things that we can go into. But first, what I want you to take a look at is this quick start here, this section. So if you go through here and read all this, you'll get a good insight on how everything works, what we can and can't do. If we keep scrolling through, we'll find some examples. So here is an example operator. Keep scrolling through, tells you how to use it. An example panel. So definitely go through here and check this out, because there's a lot more information in this than there is in any of my videos. So definitely check this out. There's also a lot of information you can search up on as well. Definitely go through this and check it out. So the next thing I want to take a look at is the Python console, which is this area over here. So the Python console is great for testing lines of code. So if you want to test something before implementing it into your script, you can test it. But it can also be used for finding out information in the scene, such as the objects or materials, things like that. And as I mentioned in a previous video, we took a look at the autocomplete, which helps us find variations on the thing that we need, for example, the node socket. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. So I'm going to type bpy.types.nodeSocket. And then we can press this autocomplete up here, or use the shortcut, which is control spacebar. So once we click this, it shows us all the available options that we can use. For example, if we want to use a boolean or a color or a float or any of these other options, then we can just type that in as well. So by using the autocomplete, we can find variations on the things that we want. I'm sure there's loads of different ways you can use this autocomplete. So let's take a look at how to list the objects in the scene. It's really simple. All we need to do is type list, open and close parentheses. So then in between here, I'm going to type bpy.data.objects. Then if we press return, it will then list all the objects within the scene. So we can see we first have the camera, we next have the cube, and then finally we have the light. And again, we can list the materials in the scene. So if I select this cube here, and then if we change this to the material tab, so we can see right now there's only one material, which is the default material. But let's say we had loads of different materials and you want to list them, we can do the same thing. So I'm going to press the up arrow on the keyboard, which will return the last thing that I entered. And then all we need to do is change it from objects. So I'm going to get rid of objects and change it to materials. Hit return. And we can see we only have that one default material. And again, you can test code. So for example, let's add a material, would be bpy.data.materials.new. Then open and close parentheses. Then inside here, I'm just going to add a name, quotation twice. In between here, let's call this my material. Then hit return. And we can see there are no errors and it's returned blue. So that's good. That means if we check over here, we now have a new material called my material. So if we click this, we can see it's different. It doesn't actually use the nodes, so you would have to add that in code as well. So I'm just going to select all this, copy it, paste it. And then here, if we just type .use_nodes = true, and then hit return, we can now see it's using nodes. So again, it's a good way to test lines of code, see if it works before you actually implement it into your script. But yeah, the Python console definitely is helpful for a number of things. So definitely check that out. So the next thing we should take a look at is the templates section, which is over here. So you can see we have a whole bunch of examples that we can use, and it's great to check out different scripts to see what they do and how they work. And we can also use them as a starting point. So for example, if we find the UI panel simple, so just make some space over here. So we could use this as a reference, or we could just go through here and make all the changes to use it in our own script. So if we hit run script, we can see that the space type is in the properties, which is over here. And then the context is object, so we obviously need an object selected. Then if we go to the object icon here, click this. And then down here we can see the Hello World panel. So again, we can go through this and make the changes that we want. Let's change this label to new panel. And since we made a change, we need to now hit run script. And now we can see it's called new panel. So yeah, the templates section is a great way to find out new scripts or find out how things work in a different setting or to use as a reference or a starting point. So again, check that out. Now the next thing I want to take a look at is the properties toolbar, and that can be opened by pressing ctrl T. Let's just make this a little bit bigger. So there we go. So we have a whole bunch of stuff to make things work better. For example, we have these options here, these three options, which actually are these three here. And by default, they're not actually active. So we normally have this. So the first option is line numbers, which will just number all these lines here. So this is going to help when you're debugging your script. If you find an error on line 200, you just find line 200 and then fix it. The next option is word wrap. So if we enable this, so when the windows are too small, it'll just wrap to a new line. And then the next thing will highlight the syntax. So for example, add these colors to the text. Things are a lot easier because just at a glance, we can see what things are. Then we have things like highlight line, which will highlight whatever line that we're on. Right now we can see the number is red when we change the line. But if we activate this, we can clearly see which line that we're currently on. Then the next thing we have is live edit, which I really like. Let me just open this panel back up. So for example, anytime we make a change down here, it says hello world. Now we made that change, we need to run the script to actually see the change. But with live edit, you don't need to do that. You just click this, and anytime we make a change, so we can see it updates in real time. Now this can cause problems. For example, if you misspell something, copy this, paste it right underneath, so it's here. Then if we just misspell this, we can see we get an error, and we can see anything below this, because this is incorrect, no longer shows up. So in a way it could be helpful, because now we can see something's wrong. We just go back and then look over the code and see that's obviously incorrect. Change it back to row, and now everything works as it should. So by using live edit, it's definitely helpful. It's something I like to use a lot when I'm working on scripts on my own. So they're the main things I wanted to look at in this properties section. The next thing we have is this find and replace. Now this is very handy when you've got big scripts. I mean, right now we've got what, 40 lines of code. That's not really much. So let me go ahead and open up a different script. So this is the VFX nodes add-on. I'm just going to make some space. And we can see it's got a whole bunch of text. So we can see it goes all the way down to 3000 lines. So if I wanted to find something specific, let's say I'm working on the glitch node, I would need to scroll through here, all these lines, and try and find this section that I want to work on. But with this find and replace, or this find section specifically, what we can do, if we click up here, so I want to find the glitch section, and then if we click find next, and it will find wherever the word glitch is. So we can see I can work on this section. If we keep pressing it, it'll just jump to the next word where it says glitch, like that. Now you can see it jumps between this glitch and that one because it's not case sensitive. If you only wanted to find glitch with the lowercase, you'd go down here to match case. Let's just jump back up here and then find next. So you can see it now skips the capital letters. Now if you keep clicking this all the way down to the last glitch word, I guess, let's go all the way down to the bottom. If we click it again, it says text not found, since there's nothing after this that says glitch. But if we wanted to go back to the top, we just need to click this wrap. So now if I do it again, it jumps back to the top and then goes down and finds where it next says glitch. So again, this section is pretty helpful for those of you who've got loads of lines of code and you don't want to scroll through and try and find the right section, because it can be a bit of a pain when you've got tons of lines. So the last thing I wanted to take a look at is the edit source. So for example, just jump to another tab. Let's say we wanted to add this resolution to our add-on, but we don't know how to do that. But what we can do is we right click on any option and then go down to edit source. It will then add the script to our text editor. So not only does it add the script to our text editor, but it also highlights the line that we were interested in. So what we could do, we could copy all of this, copy it, jump back to our original script, which was this UI panel. Let's just get rid of this one here and then paste this in. So there's a couple of things that we need to change. We haven't defined columns, so I'll need to get rid of that and change it to a row. And then next we're using something called RD, but we've not actually defined that either. So let's go back and see what that is. So we can see RD has been referenced here. So RD equals scene.render, and scene has been referenced here. So let's just copy both of these. We can now unlink the script. We no longer need it. And then here, let's just paste this in. Then let's jump back to the object section. And now within our panel, we can see we have this resolution. Again, we can copy this, paste it, just copy this one as well, paste it. And we can see it's all updating in real time because of the property live edit, which is very handy. So right now it's using resolution X for both of these. Let's just change this to resolution underscore Y, which would be the opposite, which we can now see we have X and Y. So again, it's really easy to add things to your script. You can just go to an option, edit source, see how that works, and just bring it over. So yeah, hopefully you found those 5 tips helpful. If you did, be sure to hit that like button. If you have any of your own tips that you want to share with us, go ahead and leave in the comments below. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.